Are you looking to smash your opponents at the next standard event, poison your foes in Pauper, or empty libraries in Eternal formats? No matter what way you prefer to vanquish the foul, you'll find the tools you need at channelfireball.com. We've got great prices on singles, boosters, sealed boxes, sleeves, and anything else you need to take home the win at your next PTQ or at your kitchen table. Don't get lost in a labyrinth of online shopping. Just try channelfireball.com.
All right, how's it going, everybody? Paul Cheon here, and today we're going to be playing some standard. We are signed up for a standard daily, and what I'm going to be battling with today is basically kind of a new twist on an already existing deck. And the existing deck that we all know is the blue-black control deck that Team Pantheon developed. And this list is actually not my own creation. This list was brought to me by a Moto Grinder by the account name of Von Uber. So I've named it Von Uber Sultai Control. And basically the idea was he really thinks Sultai Charm is very, very sweet in this deck. And the reason being is, there's a lot of matchups where, for example, Bioblight, not very good, or Disdainful Stroke, not very good. So the catalog ability is very, very effective. Not only that, you can still use it as a removal spell. I know it doesn't kill Mantis Rider or Siege Rhino, but it still does kill a lot of the creatures in the Devotion deck, and still kills Rabble Master, still kills Stormbreath Dragon, etc. And also the Destroy Artifact or Enchantment ability, or the clause, is actually very relevant because you can also kill Whip of Erebos, which has become far more popular in the Magic Online metagame. So I think for that reason he wanted to play it. It gives you additional things to do in the early turns of the game. Outside of that, it's pretty much the same. So one thing we had to do was, of course, revamp the mana base. So it was really, really tricky because we wanted to make sure we had enough swamps, like actual swamps, so that we can play Murk Lurkers in the sideboard. We only have three, and we have currently 12 black sources, or basically 12 quote-unquote swamps, including the Evolving Wilds, to turn on the Murk Lurkers. And that's not ideal, which is why I only have three Murk Lurkers in my deck. Outside of that, one of the biggest sacrifices you make in going three colors is we don't get to play the Life Gain lands. And we'll see how bad that is for us. Obviously, since red is our worst matchup, we still have a ton of cards dedicated to the matchup. Despite this, it's still not the best matchup, obviously. But if this deck is like, if you're expecting a field of a ton of mono red, you're not going to be playing this deck anyways. So if you want to kind of build it so that you feel like you have better game against the other decks in the field by playing green, then it might be worth it just to do that. So this is the mana base. We got some Alpine Palaces. We have three Islands of Forest and five swamps to go with two Evolving Wilds, which are basically just bad Alpine Palaces. But hey, this is what we have right now. It still fetches. We have six fetch lands to go with the Dig Through Times. We also have one spicy green card here in the Garruk Apex Predator. So hopefully that card ends up being pretty sweet. Now, I actually have never played this deck. I have played a ton of the blue-black control deck, however, so I have plenty of experience actually playing this style of deck. The main deck, pretty much everything else is the same. So basically playing four Sultai Charms and a Garruk instead of like maybe a Divination or two, an Ingenuity, and possibly like a Murderous Cut. And this deck also has 28 lands, and Von Uber swears by the 28 lands in his deck, so I'm just gonna run with it. One of the another things that this deck has that once it slows it down even more, the typical blue-black deck plays about 8 to 9 tap lands, depending on how many Evolving Wilds it plays. But this deck plays 12. The list he sent me actually at 13, and I managed to shave one and make it 12. And after we did that, we basically have access to 20 black sources, 19 blue sources, and 13 green sources. And I think that's a good place to be. I think we could shave a blue. And if we were to shave a blue, possibly we could add a Radiant Fountain, because Radiant Fountain obviously synergizes well with Purloake Ancient, but I don't know. Like, I feel like it's incorrect just to play Life Gain lands over Scry lands when given the option. Obviously, the blue-black control deck can play the lands that gain you life because, well, it's not playing that third color. But as is, we're just playing with six Scry lands. Playing with six Scry lands actually makes it so that we don't need the divinations that the other lists usually play. But Sultai Charm actually kind of does a similar thing as well. So, pretty excited to give this deck a whirl. going into the sideboard, we of course have 9 cards against mono red. We have Murk Lurker, Drown in Sorrows of Farika's Cures. These are against anything aggressive. We obviously board up to 4 Thoughtseizes. We have a couple of negates, a third Disdainful Stroke for all the mid-range decks, and we have 1 Cranial Archive. This could also have been another Pearl Lake Ancient, but I really didn't want, I guess, too many 7s. So while this could definitely be a Pearl Lake Ancient, I think it's also okay to just be a Cranial Archive, because then if they do manage to Thoughtseize a Pearl Lake Ancient or the Garruk, we can try to shuffle it back in. And you can bring this in against anything grindy. And it's actually not terrible against the Whip of Erebos deck. It cantrips and it slows them down when they're trying to go off with reanimator cards. So this is the list that we're going to take. Looks like our round one's already started. So let's get ready to battle.